Welcome to the Glory Road Television Show. I'm your host, Dr. Candace Smitherman. Today is an amazing day in the Lord, and I have an amazing guest. Dr. Naeem Collins is my guest today. He is a ball of energy. He loves to activate, empower the body of Christ, encourage them. He is a prophet to the nations. He has the fan, the Flame Global Ministry, and also Naeem Collins Ministries. He is based in Wilmington, Delaware, and he has written a book called Realms of the Prophetic, Keys to Unlock and Declare the Secrets of God. And so we're going to bring him on today so we can talk and share and learn all about the realms of the prophetic. Hello, Naeem.
Hey, how are you, Candace?
I'm good. It's wonderful to have you with me today.
Thank you so much for having me on with you.
I'm so excited. Listen, I love your book. As I was going through it, it is power-packed, full of knowledge in the prophetic. And I think what's really important for people to understand about this book is that when you open it up, it just screams understanding. You got into the Hebrew words on this, Nabi, and you know all the other words that are associated. You know, it's going to educate people in a huge way about the different types of prophets and just the ways that we need to understand who we are in the body of Christ, especially if God has called us to be a prophet to our local body, to our community, to the nations. And so I just want to encourage people that this book is truly awesome. And I want to know what inspired you to write it.
Well, what really inspired me to write this book called Realms of the Prophetic, because I felt like there's been a lot of questions surrounding the prophetic. There's been a lot of people that really is curious about it, and especially in Christendom, that people, you know, who are starting out or even some who are seasoned prophets, you know, they want to kind of know a little bit more about it. They want a more in-depth study on it. And so what really inspired me is to provide more prophetic education, because I felt that as I minister and as I travel around the country, there is more and more people, even though there is a plethora of information out there and books on the prophetic, but you have a emergent generation that's rising up that are very curious about it, and they're coming into the prophetic. And so, but what is very key about this particular book, because I wanted to be able to understand the different realms of it. And what I mean by that is to provide more distinction, because what happens, and I've learned, Candace, is that what people usually do is when people prophesy, automatically people are grouped into being a prophet. And oftentimes, you know, there is very limited understanding of what the prophetic really entails and actually what a prophet does. And so I wanted to just provide a little bit more in-depth, distinctive, comprehensive, exhaustive study on the subject matter to help people walk them through the different various realms, because you hear terms like prophetic, you hear, you know, prophecy, you hear some of those terms, and or prophetic anointing, spirit of prophecy, gift of prophecy. And so I wanted to go to each one of them, and I kind of highlight in my book about eight different realms of it and how you can walk in all eight of them as a believer. And so, and just to provide a little bit more distinction definition to the ministry called the prophetic.
That's so awesome. And it is very educational. I mean, people that have questions about the prophetic, all they have to do is open your book and they are going to have it. So that's really awesome. Now, you know, your brother and I are friends, Dr. Hakeem.
Yes.
And you guys are kind of nicknamed the twin prophets.
Yes.
And so tell the viewers a little bit about, you know, when you began to notice your prophetic gift, and how did God call you out and really set you apart and begin to get you on this journey of itinerant ministry?
Yes, as the Candace indicated, I do have a twin brother named Dr. Hakeem Collins, and we actually are called the twin prophets. That's what most people know us as. And we travel around the country together ministering. And so we have a prophetic ministry. But what started me and my brother on this journey was probably back when we were about 7 to 8 years old. We were in a Baptist church, and our pastor at the time was blind. And the Lord began to open my brother's eyes. And, you know, at the same time, we began to see a large figure behind our pastor as he was ministering. And it was the Lord Jesus. And and we felt the Lord was calling us. We just felt a pull of love pulling us to the altar to come to the Lord Jesus, and we did. And at that time, we got baptized, and from there, that kind of started that journey. But when we were young, I can recall my brother and I, you know, sharing some things with our friends, because we always kind of had a knowing. We always pretty much saw things before they happened, and you know, and we would warn our friends saying, "Don't do this. If you go here, something is going to happen." And usually, almost all the time when it happened, you know, my brother would say, "I told you so." And we didn't really know that that was prophetic, because we didn't have a language for it at the time. You know, they didn't teach on the prophetic or prophets in the Baptist church. And so, of course, you know, it was a sovereign call. And so when we were about 14, we were in a meeting. We were actually singing on a choir. And a woman of God called my brother and I out of the choir. We were singing, and she began to prophesy to us. And so that was the first time we were really exposed to the prophetic, or someone speaking prophetically to us. And she began to say that God has called my brother and I to be prophets, and he was going to use us greatly, and all those things. And so we were about 14 at the time, and she laid hands on us, and that's pretty much was the story. And then from there, we began to have really supernatural angelic encounters. We were able to see in the realm of the spirit. And so that pretty much jumpstart our journey into the prophetic for much, you know.
Wow. That's really awesome. I had to ask that because I know there's a lot of people that probably want to ask you guys that question. So I thought I would make sure I got it on tape.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
Well, I want to know, there's three different types of prophets that you highlight right away. Bam, as soon as we get in your book, you outline those three types of prophets right off the bat. Yeah. Can you share with the viewers today, what are those three types of prophets?
Yeah. So in scripture, mostly people are familiar when you talk about prophet, you know, the scriptures. And I wanted to go into more of a Hebrew etymology of what the scripture biblically defines the prophet. And when I was able to discover that you have the prophet, who is God's spokesperson or his mouthpiece, which was considered the Nabi. And then you have the seer prophet. The seer prophet is made up of two different streams, which is the Ro'ah or the Hazah prophet. And so there's two streams in the seer realm. And then there's a third that oftentimes is kind of overlooked. A lot of times people do not consider this as an official office, but it is the office of the dreamer. And so you got the prophet, the seer, and the dreamer. And so those are the three essential offices that the Lord showed me in scripture. And I could to show you that in Joel chapter 2 and in Acts chapter 2 begins to define that in the last days, God said that he will pour out his spirit upon all flesh. And he says, your sons and daughters shall prophesy. And so you could see that the first wave of the prophetic in the last days is going to be the prophet. And then he says, your young men shall see visions. And so that is speaking relatively of the seer anointing or the seer mantle that's being poured out. And then he says, your old men shall dream dreams. And that is talking about the dreamer. So we know that Joseph was a dreamer. So the Lord began to reveal to me that in this last days, there will be enormous and there will be tremendous prophetic activities. There will be the outpouring of the Spirit. So God poured out his prophetic spirit. And in that prophetic spirit, there were three realms that was released in the last days. And you'll see that phenomenal prophetic activity will happen through the prophet, through the seer, or the visionary prophet, and the dreamer.
Wow, that's really awesome. I know that that's generating right now in people's hearts are going, wow, you know, I totally, totally need to learn more about this, more about who each one of them may be. And I love in the beginning of this conversation, you kind of listed, you know, just because you prophesy, that doesn't make you a prophet. Can you talk to the body of Christ a little bit about its position in that area, the difference between office of prophet and the word that all shall prophesy?
Yeah, and that's one of the things that I wanted to kind of clarify, because oftentimes in the body of Christ, there is a miseducation or a lack thereof of what the prophetic is, because oftentimes, Candace, people that prophesy, people just automatically say, well, he's a prophet or she's a prophetess. And so I wanted to go in scriptures to help people to navigate through the different realms, because the office of the prophet is the highest. It is God's second officer in his church. And so that takes some time, you know, and, you know, oftentimes people get a prophecy that God has called them to the prophetic or called them to be a prophet, and they get it one day and then they start doing their business cards the next day. And there has to be a lot more education to the prophetic. So what I wanted to do is to help to just bring more clarity and definition to that. And simply the difference is that the scripture says that we all may prophesy. And so because we have the Holy Spirit, every believer by default has the capacity by the Lord Jesus Christ and through the Holy Spirit to prophesy. So every spirit-filled believer can prophesy, and you have the capacity to prophesy, but not all are prophets. And so what's the clear distinction is that an office prophet, or one that prophesies, can prophesy by nature. It is a part of his or her nature. And though we all have the Holy Spirit, but we all don't have that authority, we don't have that latitude and that anointing, so to speak, to be able to speak on his behalf. We all can speak for God, but the prophet functions more than just in saying, thus saith the Lord. And so, and a prophet, you know, just can prophesy in his or her sleep. They can wake up, it can just, you know, they can activate it, they can just function in it, you know, because that's their office, that's their seat, that is their position. And so the distinction is that a prophet has the authority to do so, and one who can prophesy by the gift, there's some limitations to that, you know, is through edification, exhortation, and comfort. And so there's some limitations to the prophetic. But so that's clearly the distinction, just to give you somewhat of a simple definition.
No, that's awesome. And I think that that's good for everyone to know, because it means that the body of Christ should have the confidence and the encouragement to be able to step into a place of prophesying as part of the body to edify, uplift, and encourage it. But not every single person that's prophesying has been given the specific office of the prophet. They may have been given other additional giftings too. And then as part of the body, they prophesy, right? Because where the spirit of Jesus is, the spirit of prophecy is, right?
Yes.
So people are going to be speaking out in that regard. And so it is for all of us, but some are called to the fivefold ministry. And one of those is the office of prophet.
Absolutely.
Along with apostle, pastor, teacher, evangelist in there. Now, I know for myself personally, you know, I learned to prophesy as a member of the body of Christ early on. But it was only after a period of time that the Lord singled me out and he anointed me and set me apart through consecration, fasting, a whole lot of stuff. Because the character stuff that a prophet has got to go through is absolutely, you know, unbelievable. I mean, God had just stripped so much off of me. And I'm still not saying, he's still stripped. I mean, you know, he strips in order to bring the prophet down to the place of having a heart to cry out to God and to cry out on behalf of the people. And also, that's the priestly role, but also, too, to bring down that place where God says, but they have to understand it and they have to be inspired by it and then go before and help other people understand this is what God says, and we're going to inspire you through the word to get into the place that God is calling you to be in. And I know for myself, you know, it took a while before God brought me to that place. I was very immature and I had a lot of growth that needed me. And everybody does, because when you first get born again, you got a lot of growth. There's a lot of soul transformation that takes place.
I want to also add to Candace, because you just made a phenomenal point about the process, the prophetic process of a prophet. And because a prophet does not just function in their spiritual capacities or faculties just with the gift, but they function more in character. And one of the things you had indicated is that even prophets today, they're so used to accustomed functioning in their priestly role. But the role of the prophet also in the Old Testament, they were functioned also with the king. And, you know, you see many times the prophet Nathan and you had Seer Gad were in David's realm and they were assisting and helping him as advisors. And so they were ones that bring strategy. They were also able to bring counsel and direction and guidance. And so the role of the prophetic is not just Thus Saith the Lord, but they also had that navigational aspect to the prophetic, that ability to give direction and to provide guidance and also wisdom to kings. And so we're so used in the church in functioning in our priestly garments, but also the scripture says that we are king priests. And so at times we have to then shift out of our priestly garments or duties or roles as prophets and prophetic people, but then also shift into more of a governmental kingly aspect where we learn how to reign and rule and provide strategy for kings in the nations or heads of states. And so the prophet was not just giving words to just, you know, people, but they were also advisors of kings. And so, you know, so our role is just much bigger than just the church.
That's so good. That is awesome. Well, I want to let people know where they can get your book and what it looks like. So here is Dr. Naeem's book, Realms of the Prophetic. And you can find his book by going to NaeemCollinsMinistries.com. Or please go to Amazon, Barnes & Noble, everywhere that Christian books are sold, because there you will find his book. I would also like to share with you all about a resource that I have, which goes very well with this book, called Baptism by Fire. And it's a two-disc set or a two MP3 set, but I also give you an extra free CD or MP3, How to Activate Your Spiritual Gifts. And so it's an activation CD that's going to help you be able to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit and begin to activate the fire on the inside of you to bring forth the giftings that God has called you to walk in. And you can find that at CandaceSmitheman.com. The two of them together would go nicely for your learning, for sure. all right, let's continue on with the conversation. So I want to know, in this book, what is your most favorite chapter?
One of my favorite chapters in the book, I have a few, you know, of course, but one of my favorite chapters in the book is on prophetic mantles. I think, because you hear that term all the time, prophetic mantles. And as I was doing a study on that, I found there were some extraordinary discoveries about a mantle. It wasn't just a cloak or a coat or a covering. But the prophet's mantle was more than just that, but it encompasses much more. And so I've learned that the mantle is not just a cloak or coat or a covering, but it's also an armor. And it's the prophet's uniform, just as you will find a police officer who wears a uniform, you know, an FBI agent or someone that functions as an officer or an official officer, someone who has been sworn in. And so the prophet's mantle was also his uniform. It was also his armor. It was also his seal. It was a part of his charge. And so one of the things that I found that the prophet's mantle was, is that a mantle helped during the time in ancient Israel, that when they would go into the desert, and we know that desert places are very hot. It is arid, is just, you know, and at night it becomes extremely cold. Many people don't know that, but during the night, the desert place can be extremely cold. And the prophet's mantle had the ability to cover and to protect the prophet from the outside elements. And so the spiritual implication to that is to help you to understand that a prophet has the ability to go into any atmosphere or any element, and God's cloak or his coat that is on the prophet has the ability to protect him against all kinds of elements that is against him. And also the uniform also helped to define the prophet's distinction, like Joseph when he had the cloak of many colors, and his brothers was able to see from a distance that Joseph was coming. And so here comes this dreamer of dreams. They were able to recognize Joseph because of the distinction of his mantle. And so it helped to define a prophet's rank. So oftentimes a prophet who worked in or functioned in a more kingly or in the king's palace, he would have more a kingly mantle. And some who were like Elijah, who carried a hairy or a mantle of hair or fur, you know. And so he was more for the desert, you know, for the wilderness place. And so it speaks of the prophet's nature and his assignment. And so I just found, Candace, some extraordinary things. You got to get the book to find out more. But it was powerful to recognize that the prophet's mantle, his uniform, had so many amenities to it that helped him function in and out of different spiritual climates, atmospheres, and environments.
That's good. That is really good. And I noticed for myself that there's different garments I have to put on for the different arenas that God is calling me to prophesy in.
And absolutely.
So that is really powerful learning right there. So now, you mentioned in the book that there's some keys that came from the ancient prophets that can help us be able to break off spiritual famine, drought, curses in our lives. Tell us a little bit about that.
All right. Well, so one of the things, too, when I was researching and I wanted to kind of know the prophet's order and wanted to know more about the ancient prophets, because no one can teach the prophetic better than the biblical prophets. They're the best to do it. And so they function in the class all by itself. And so the Lord told me that they left keys for us for successive generations to live in and to walk in. And so they provide these keys. And one of the things that I noticed is that during certain seasons of famine, the Lord said in his word in Amos that, you know, that he would send a famine. And he said the famine would not be of food. It would not be of water or a thirst of water, but it would be of hearing the word of the Lord. And so in certain seasons of famine, I recognize is there is a famine where there is a lack thereof or scarcity of hearing the word of the Lord, just like in the days of Samuel, in Samuel 1 Samuel chapter 3, when it talks about that there was a rarity and the word of the Lord was precious in those days. And so what God showed me is that that Elijah, for example, one of the keys that Elijah used during season of famine when he had prophesied drought is that intercession. And I saw that before Elijah went to Ahab and Jezebel and said there will be no dew, no rain for 3.5 years except by my word. Prior to that, he asked the Lord in James chapter 5. And the Bible gives us the key that he did not prophesy. He first prayed that God would shut up the heavens. And the Lord gave him the key to release. And so one of the keys that I found is that it's in the mouth of the prophet. And that's why he was boldly able to go to Jezebel and Ahab and shut them down and say, God will not release rain or dew. He will not endorse your activity except by my word. And God put a key in the mouth of Elijah. But prior to that, he had to pray. And so intercession gives us keys to be able to shut down demonic or satanic operations. And also the Lord says that in the mouth of the prophetic, not just the prophets, but in the mouth of the believer, that when you intercede and you ask God to shut down systems that are diabolical and that is against you, God said, I will give you the key to begin to prophesy against it. And so that's why it didn't matter how many prophets prophesied, how many prophets of Baal prophesied, God was not releasing rain until Elijah prophesied. And so that was just one of the keys that God has shown me, is that in your season of drought, in your season of famine, God puts words, the word of the Lord is in your mouth to release revival and release fire. And so you got to know that your intercession is a key to shut things down or to open up the heavens.
Wow, that's powerful. Listen, prophet of the Lord, I'm going to put you on the spot right now.
Okay.
There's people that are watching the show, and they need a key for their problem, for their issue. They need a prophet to go and to begin to speak the keys, to carry the keys, to do what's necessary. So let's just ask the Lord right now to just come into this space with the two of us and the people that are watching right now, and I'm going to have you just pray that some keys that are going to be released from heaven for these people and their needs.
So, Father, we decree and declare, and we thank you, Father, that even as you are on this broadcast, those that are watching live, and even those that are coming on later, we say, Father, that you would just release your prophetic keys in your mouth of your servants, the prophets. Father, we thank you, Lord, that even as Elijah had went to the widow woman and he declared to her, you know, what you're about to do, and Lord, that you even just shifted her economy because it was in the mouth of your servant, the prophet. And so, Lord, that every individual that are watching, we just release keys, Lord, that economy is in the mouth of the prophetic. Mm-hmm. And so we thank you that we have the capacity and the supernatural faculties to be able to release and to prophesy. So, Lord, I just activate every believer that is watching that they will step into their prophetic capacities. They will just open their mouth by faith and just release. We break down every spiritual dam. We break every limitation. We speak to right now to every mountain. We say, thou be thou removed in the name of Jesus. We decree and declare, Father, that they will arise and know that you put your words in their mouth. Lord, we say that your word says, so whatever we decree a thing, so shall it be established. So we just decree open heavens. We break every famine. We break every lack. We break every drought. We come against every generational curse. We nullify it. We veto it. We overrule it. And we legislate it. And we decree that through the words of our mouth and the words of our testimony, we decree by the spirit of prophecy and through the office of the prophetic that we unlock the heavens. We release revival. And Lord, I speak to every gift, every anointing. We say, let it to arise right now. I release a prophetic grace upon every individual that's watching. And I just activate them. We stir it up. We activate it. And we come in divine agreement. And we say that it is so. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Amen and amen. Hallelujah. As another prophet of the Lord, I agree with you. I also want to tell you, as you know, this past week, there's been a lot of spiritual warfare, you know, for the last couple of weeks. But God has been releasing keys for advancement. And so I believe what you did today is you're helping that prophetic flow from heaven into the earth to be able to release the keys of advancement into the hands of the people that need them today. So folks, you need to lift up your hand and you need to grab a hold of that key that's been released from heaven and you need to put it into practice. This is how we activate what has been spoken. Is we take that key, we believe it, and in faith we begin to go and activate. So begin to ask the Lord what it is that that he's speaking to your heart. What key has he released, and how can you activate this key to step into the plan and purpose, the new mantle, the new assignment, because this is the time of new assignments, because in September 29th, the calendar's going to turn over. There's going to be double portion that comes to his people after Rosh Hashanah, and you need to be a part of that. So hallelujah. God, I feel that people are being shaken right now. Shifting is happening. New things are taking place. And so you need to run with those keys that have been prophesied in the name of Jesus.
Glory, glory. And let me just say, Willis, just real quick, that the Lord has given many of you mantles, special specialties. One of the things about the prophetic and prophets is prophets are specialists. And so the Lord has given you a mantle. Each one of you that are watching, you have a specialized mantle. And I'd say the world says work your magic. They may say even work your mojo. But I heard the Lord say, for many of you that are watching, the Lord says to work your mantle. Your mantle has the capacity to shift, and it is a key. Just like the woman that had an issue of blood, and when she came around Jesus, she touched his mantle. She touched his cloak, and what it did, it released virtue.